Since the critical acclaim of Jordan Peele's 2017 horror thriller film Get Out, there seems to be somewhat of a rise of other black filmmakers creating visions that encapsulate social commentary and horror. Although Peele is not the first black filmmaker to attempt this feat, he is, in my opinion, one of few to have been able to successfully create social thrillers in modern times. Social thrillers, simply put, focus on horror that highlights different forms of oppression in society. When I say social thriller, think of The Stepford Wives, which focuses on feminist-turned-housewives, or It Follows, which discusses the moral panic surrounding sexually transmitted diseases. Without the typical jump scares and excessive gore, Get Out makes a mark for itself with its sharp social and political commentary. Peele is able to capture aspects of a post-Obama society where a widespread notion of racism ceasing to exist was prevalent simply because a black man was elected president. We find our main character Chris, a black man, visiting his white girlfriend's family in a location that appears for most people to be relatively safe, a white affluent neighborhood. Throughout his stay, Chris encounters multiple microaggressions at the hands of white liberals, and the true horror of the film is through these interactions and the sunken place, which is an overall stand-in for assimilation, incarceration, slavery, and the silencing of black people. With the success of Get Out and the multiple conversations that ensued, there came an outpour of black directors wanting to tell their stories about the experiences of what it's like to be black in America. But there's a reason why Get Out has been so successful, and why black directors following in Peele's footsteps have not been able to create similarly impactful movies.
I call it a social thriller.
There you just did it.
That's the new genre. Yeah, that's what, you know, it's very inspired by Stepford Wives, Rosemary's Baby.
Yeah.
You know, these movies that are creepy, but, you know, humanity is like the creepiest part at the center of it.
Yeah, you're right. Let me try.
Nowadays, it seems as though the retelling of black pain by black directors is what is trending, with little thought behind how black audience members will perceive these works. Most of these current movies or TV shows seem to put forth graphic and excessive scenes of brutalization towards black people to show how horrible racism can be, just to serve as a shock value and nothing more. When looking at current social thrillers, I think it's important to ask two major questions. Who is the audience and what is the message? Other stories such as Bad Hair and Them suffer in these ways because they're unable to answer one or two of the previous questions, among other weaknesses. Take for instance the 2020 horror thriller film Bad Hair, directed and written by Justin Simien. Bad Hair interweaves the very real discussion of assimilation and respectability politics, which are rooted in the way black women wear and style their hair in a professional setting. Anna, our main character, gets a weave to fit into her corporate job, and as time goes on, her weave becomes evil and takes on a mind of its own. While the movie would have been decent if it focused on this topic in depth, Bad Hair takes many detours through subplots that don't get fully fleshed out and suffers numerous tonal inconsistencies. Although Bad Hair is supposed to be a love story to black women, Simien hardly takes the time to explore the complex relationship black women have with their hair. As Jordan Searles put it, a viewer can watch his work and see a man trying to explore the complexities of black women with an understanding of how misogynoir affects the way we move in the world. But good intentions can only take him so far, and there is a sense that he may have reached beyond the scope of Anna's story in order to bring forth cultural judgments about black women's hair that aren't really his to make. As things get worse for Anna, she finds herself reading slave-era folklore, suggesting there is an inherent evil in the pursuit of straight hair. By the end of the film, it's hard to know what Simien is trying to say about black women. Weaves in the film are seen as a one-dimensional object, only meant for the corporate world and white approval, which is not true in the slightest. If this narrative were true, weaves would not come in fashion colors, different lengths, or textures. When asked about the criticism Simien's film received at the hands of black female critics, the supposed target audience of the film, he was dismissive of their claims and stated that people weren't ready to receive a movie that showed a perspective from a black queer gaze. Coming from a movie that had absolutely zero queer subtext, it's hard for me to see Simien's perspective. Mariam Diallo is a director whose work I appreciate, as she's able to aptly discuss the relationship black women have with their hair. A 4-minute short by the same name written by Diallo addresses the lens through which black women see their natural hair. Another short by Diallo, Hairwolf, addresses white women and their appropriation of traditional black hairstyles through a satirical horror lens. Diallo is able to succeed in her storytelling because she's aware of her audience and the message that she wants to send forward. And then we get to Amazon Prime's horror series, Them, which I had the misfortune of watching. And to set the record straight, even though Shahidi Wright Joseph, one of the actors from Peele's Us, is also in Them, the two shows are not related. Them is not a sequel, prequel, or alternate universe to Us, and the two mediums cannot be further from each other. Also, even though the majority of the episodes and the seasons have white directors, I am still considering them to be a story told through a black lens, as Little Marvin created the series and wrote almost half of the episodes. Them follows the Emerys, a black family in the 1950s, and their move from North Carolina to an all-white neighborhood in California. Very quickly, the Emerys and the audience are made aware that the neighbors don't take kindly to black people, and the series takes off from there. A recent Los Angeles Times article came out that was titled, "The Racist Violence in Amazon's New Series Left Execs Shaken. Does it go too far?" And all I have to say to that is 110% yes. I won't mention the specifics of the brutalization, but Angelica Jade Bastien wrote a review that discussed the issues of excessive gore in Them that I really enjoyed reading and recommend you checking out. Lovia Jacqui from The Hollywood Reporter summarizes my thoughts on the series. Them neither taps fully into the chivalry potential of traditional horror, nor adds much to what many viewers already know about racial terror in the United States. During a time when violence against black people can so easily be witnessed through screens and social feeds, peddling black terror without a fresh exploration of its roots or its future is at best a bit boring, and at worst gratuitous. If this kind of art doesn't say anything new or different about the relationship between black people and America, then it risks becoming a little more than trauma porn. After all, do we really need more images of black people dying? A look into the history of the treatment, discrimination, and prejudice surrounding black people has shown that black history can indeed be black horror. So, why does Them feel the need to put traumatizing after traumatizing after traumatizing scenes of black people on screen episode after episode? And it begs the question, who is Them even made for? Out of the mouth of Marvin himself, he stated that when he wrote episode 5, one of the more gut-wrenchingly violent episodes of the series that I personally could not finish, that he wanted to grab the viewer by the jugular and force them to contend with the history of violence against black bodies in this country. If I did that in a way that you've seen before, like an act of police brutality or a slave narrative, that, in some way, creates a distance or a salve for the viewer. I've seen it before. But this is so abominable, it defies you to see it that way. Black trauma and pain has been used for entertainment for white individuals for centuries. And if the only way you can understand black pain and trauma is through graphic brutalizations of black people on screen, then I don't know what to tell you. Them is a visually striking and well-acted series, although the show seems more focused on trying to outdo itself in presenting racist acts in the most disturbing ways, instead of creating a coherent plot or storyline with meaning. As the series progresses, it becomes more and more abstract in its presentation of the material and loses the plot altogether. What Jordan Peele has done is revitalize the genre and allow horror to have a focus on the black experience. I'm not saying that every writer needs to have the craftsmanship of Jordan Peele, because where would be the originality in that? But it's clear that black directors of late are blindingly imitating Peele's let's tell a story about racialized oppression without thinking much about how certain scenes will play out. It does seem as though current social thrillers are written to explain concepts to white and non-black people instead of creating content for black audience members to enjoy. I'm aware that trauma exists in the lives of almost all black people, and that will find a way in their retellings of stories in one way or another. But there's a way to go about telling stories of trauma that doesn't make it the center of your story. All of these films and TV shows deal with black trauma in one way or another. Despite trauma existing in these worlds, it's not the main focus of these stories, as a unique, well-rounded, and fleshed-out narrative is still able to be told. For the future of social thrillers focused on black narratives, I would like to see a more nuanced and empathetic storytelling of the black experience. Some of my favorite black directors have been able to achieve this feat in their tellings of social thrillers, such as Boots Riley with his 2018 dark comedy, Sorry to Bother You, and Chinoye Chukwu's 2019 film, Clemency. As this genre is going through a resurge, it has so much more potential than to continue to rehash traumatic situations of black pain. And I do have hope that future black directors will be given the opportunity to tell their stories in a more well-rounded way.